To congregate and study his truths. The Lord has allowed us to gather together for another investigation of truth. And we trust, hope, and we pray that each one of us have come to study God's word. In Leviticus 10 that was read to us, it's certainly important for all of us to know the context of the Bible.
Yes.
Before you begin to approach God's word, that's what you need to know. Now, Leviticus 10 comes out of a section where God had called Moses up on Mount Sinai. After the preparatory material is given in Exodus 1 and 2, and verse number 3 forward in the very next chapter.
All right.
Here God commissioned Moses to go down and tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And two chapters later, in verse 2, Pharaoh says, "Who is the Lord that I shall obey his voice? I'm a king. I don't have to listen to this man."
Yes, sir.
And as a result, in the next chapters, chapter 7 and following, God sent these 10 plagues upon Pharaoh to convince him to let his people go. Now we'll begin in Exodus 13 through 18. After God's people leave Egyptian bondage, it takes them 2 months to get to Exodus 19:1. It takes them 2 months to get to Sinai. That's where they were headed. Now, when they get to Mount Sinai, that section of scripture, you and I need to know. Because that's Exodus 19:1, all of the book of Leviticus, and the first 10 chapters of the book of Numbers. That block of scripture goes together. If you're going to study Exodus 19:1, you're going to have to study the 10 chapters, the first 10 chapters of the book of Numbers, because that material goes together. Now, when Moses gets to Mount Sinai, there were some very interesting things that happened. It was at the foot of Mount Sinai where they organized the number of the children of Israel. It was at the foot of Mount Sinai where they made the golden calf. It was at the foot of Mount Sinai where they made the tabernacle. And it was on this occasion that God called Moses up on Mount Sinai and then gave man that first written law that man ever had.
Right.
Now you're going to find that law in what we're talking about this morning. There are some other things that happened on the Mount Sinai.
Right.
They was given the sacrificial priests and how they were to function. They were given the sacrificial offerings that we'll see in Leviticus 2, 3, 4, 6, and 7. Now, when you get to Numbers chapter 10, we need to know and understand that. And the reason why is because if we don't understand that, when we get to Leviticus 10 and just lift Leviticus 10 up, then perhaps it may not be clear to you. Now turn your Bibles to Leviticus 10.
All right.
Now remember, here God give the children of Israel the sacrificial priesthood, the sacrificial offerings, gave them the law that's going to govern them until that law will come or be abrogated on the cross.
Right.
Now Leviticus 10 verses 1 and 2 has already been read to you. Now, this is what we need to find out this morning.
Right.
I want to look at 4 delightful dimensions. I want to look at number 1 in verses 1 and 2. I want to look at a positional privilege,
right.
a special privilege that these boys had in Leviticus 10.
Right.
Then secondly, we need to look at a sacred place.
Right.
Then number 3, I want to look at a specific prayer on that one, I know. I know I'm going to need some prayer on that one. I want to look at a specific pattern. When we talk about specificity, we are talking about mandates that God has given that we must do it exactly as God said. We must do it exactly as God said. We need to understand that. And I want to look at this pattern here. I want to look at this special pattern. And then the fourth point I want to look at, I want to look at a strange presentation. And then we'll conclude our thinking together with some sacrificial principles. Now, here we have these boys and the biblical scene. This is what I want to show you. I'm going to show you at least 10 things that these boys was doing right. That's what I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you at least 10 commands that these boys were obeying. I'm going to show you that they were the right boys. Not only were they the right boys, if they were the right boys, they had to have the right father. And if they got to have the right father, got to be from the right tribe. And if they're from the right tribe, that means they're the right priests. And then I'm going to show you they were worshiping the right God. Not only that, they had on the right clothes. Not only that, they were worshiping in the right place. Not only that, they were using the right censer. Not only that, they were using the right incense. Not only that, they were obeying the right command. But verse number 2 says what?
And there went out fire from the Lord.
There went out fire from the Lord. And then what? And divide them. Hold it, wait a minute. You mean to tell me these were the right boys? Well, you mean to tell me they were from the right tribe? Yes. You mean to tell me they had the right father? Yes. You mean to tell me they were in the right place? Yes. You mean to tell me they were worshiping the right God? Yes. You mean to tell me they had the right censer? Yes. You mean to tell me they had the right incense? Yes. You mean to tell me they were obeying the right command? Yes. And then God killed them? We got to find out something this morning, baby. We got to find out something this morning. I'm telling you, when God has a specific pattern, we got to do it exactly as God said. These boys, I'll show you 10 things that these boys were doing right. And yet, verse number 2 says, what did verse number 2 say?
And there went out fire from the Lord.
There went out fire from the Lord. And devoured them.
And devoured them.
And they died before all these right things these boys were doing.
Amen.
All these right things these boys were doing, they were in the right place. They were worshiping the right God.
Yep.
They had on the right clothes.
Yes,
they were from the right tribe.
Yes,
they had the right father.
Yes,
they had the right incense.
Yes,
they had the right censer.
Yes,
they were obeying the right command.
Yes,
and yet and still, God killed those boys. And we got to find out what happened this morning. We got to find out something happened this morning, friend. It makes no difference how many right things you're doing. It don't take but one wrong thing, neighbor. That's all it takes. It don't take but one wrong thing. And we need to understand that. We need to understand that. When there is a specific pattern, neighbor, you got to do it according to the pattern. You got to do it exactly as God said, and we'll see that in just a moment. Now, go back to verse number 1. Verse number 1. Notice what it says.
And
Nadab and Abihu,
the sons of Aaron.
Now hold it, wait a minute. This Aaronic priesthood.
Yes, sir.
This Aaronic priesthood. Aaron was this Aaronic priesthood.
That's right.
Older brother Moses.
That's all right.
Sister Miriam.
Yes, sir.
Now here, in order for you to worship God.
Yes, sir.
This is a special privilege.
Yes,
can you imagine? Only 5 people, Aaron and his 4 boys, Nadab, Abihu, Ithamar, and Eleazar, those 4 boys,
that's it.
They have the special privilege
that's it.
Of worshiping God.
All right.
You and I have a special privilege this morning,
yes, sir.
Of worshiping God. But when we worship God, neighbor, we have to do it according to the pattern.
Amen.
Oh, that's what I teach, neighbor.
Yes,
I'm telling you, I teach pattern theology.
Yes,
Because it's written all the way from heaven.
Yes, sir.
And it's going to take us back to heaven when we follow that pattern, neighbor.
Amen.
There is a specific pattern. And when God gives this pattern, these boys got to follow this pattern.
Amen.
Well, hold it, wait a minute. They were the right boys. They had the right father. Aaron was their father. They was from the right tribe. They was from the Levitical tribe. But you had to be a direct prerequisite of it. Everybody that was from the Levitical tribe could not worship God. They couldn't go up in that holy place. Everybody from the Levitical tribe. You see that Levitical tribe? It was divided into four compartments. Because there was a man by the name of Levi. And Levi had three boys. Isn't that right? Levi had a boy named Merari. Had a boy named Gershom. And had a boy named Kohath. And the Kohaths, they were responsible for transporting the Ark of the Covenant. They had to transport it on their shoulders. Now the Merari tribe. The Merari, they traveled with the lighter instruments and carried that. The Gershonites, they had to carry the heavier instruments, but they could not go up into this sacred place. You had to be a direct prerequisite of Aaron, neighbor. Oh, yes, you did. And even though Levi had a responsibility, and even though Levi's sons had a responsibility, they could not go up in there. Numbers 4, verse number 15 and verse 21. If they went up in there, you know what happened to them, neighbor?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That's it.
You know what happened to them?
That's it.
They're going to die.
That's what God said.
Because there is a specific pattern. Now, Nadab and Abihu, Aaron's sons, these boys had a special privilege. They had a rare privilege of worshiping Almighty God. They had a rare privilege of worshiping Almighty God. So here we have the right boys. These boys are in the right place. These boys got the right ball. These boys got the right clothes on. These boys from the right tribe. These boys are worshiping the right God. These boys had the right censer. These boys used the right incense. These boys was obeying the right command. But yet, verse number 2 says, God instantaneously burned these boys up.
Right.
Hold it, wait a minute.
Right.
Oh, I can hear from humanism now.
Right.
I can hear from humanism now. Oh, as long as we doing this for the Lord, and as long as we doing that for the Lord, I mean, God is not going to destroy us. God's grace is going to cover us because we're doing at least 10 things that's right. These boys were doing at least 10 things that was right. It doesn't take but one thing that's wrong to damn one soul to hell. That's all it takes. It doesn't take 100 things. It doesn't take 1,000 things. It doesn't take 1,000,000 things. All it takes is just one unrepentant sin.
Amen.
That's all it takes, neighbor. One unrepentant sin. Now notice what it says. Read just a little bit more.
And about who the son of Aaron?
Sons of Aaron.
Took either of them his sister.
Took either of them his sister.
And put fire therein.
Put fire therein.
And put incense thereon.
Incense thereon.
And offer strange.
Notice what it did. Offered strange
fire before the Lord.
Brothers and sisters, friends and neighbors, look at these boys. All of these right things that they were doing. Let's go back to Exodus 28.
Come on,
let's go back to Exodus 28. Right. And let's get some of this here.
That's all right.
Go back to Exodus 28.
That's all right.
Now remember, in Exodus 19, all of the book of Leviticus, I sure hope you're not afraid of marking in your Bible.
Well,
come on. Because we that are members of the Lord's church, we are Bible markers. Your Bible ought to be marked up. You're a Christian.
Amen.
So here, Exodus 19, all of the book of Leviticus, the first 10 chapters of the book of Numbers, God give these laws to those 603,550 people that left Egyptian bondage. Now I know he's going to reiterate these laws when that first generation die out. And then we're going to get the book of Deuteronomy, which just simply means second law. It's going to be a repeating of the laws that God had already given to those earlier people. I hope you're following me this morning. When you get the book of Deuteronomy, you're simply reading the same laws, because there has been another generation that was born out there in the wilderness, and God does not want these people to make the same mistakes that their hard-headed mamas and daddies did. Yeah. So now we'll get the book of Deuteronomy, which only lasted for you for 2 months. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in the weeks, in the days to come. Now here, in Exodus 28, notice something here. I said that these were the right boys. I said these boys had on the right clothes. Exodus 28, verse number 1. What does the Bible say?
And take thou unto thee Aaron, thy brother, and his sons with him.
Now notice God says to Moses, get your brother Aaron.
Yes, sir.
And get your sons. Not Levi, not Reuben, nor Simeon, nor Levi, nor Judah, nor Issachar, nor Zebulun, nor Gad, nor Asher, nor Joseph, nor Benjamin.
That's right.
You can't take any of this.
No, sir.
Who do you say take?
That's right. Take unto thee Aaron, thy brother, and his sons.
Aaron and Aaron's sons.
From among the children of Israel.
Who were they?
That they may minister unto me.
That they may minister to me in the priest's office.
Even Aaron.
Aaron.
Nadab.
About you.
Eleazar.
And Ithamar.
Aaron.
Those were the guys. Those were Aaron's sons. That's what God said. They had a rare, special privilege of worshiping God. Now, notice something else in Exodus chapter 28. Read just a little bit more of that.
And God shall make holy garments for Aaron, thy brother, for glory and for beauty.
Notice, now there's going to be some special garments for Aaron. Special garments for Aaron, not for Michael Shepherd, or not for some of these other preachers around here that's still trying to wear special garments. You see, neighbor, the priesthood been changed. And even some of my brethren don't know that. Still want to wear priestly garments. Priesthood have been changed. For the priesthood being changed. There's made of necessity that changed also the law. For he of whom these things were spoken of, pertaining to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at all. It is evident. Our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning the priesthood, Hebrews 7, 12 and 14. That priesthood has been changed. We don't wear robes. Because the priesthood has been changed. Let me say it again, because I believe I said something. Since it's going to be on YouTube, we don't wear robes. The priesthood have been changed. That's something for Catholic and all of those people. Faith to come in some kind of way now has special significance. Here in this second dispensational law, God designated that for Aaron and his sons. That your biblical priesthood that had a direct prerequisite of Aaron. Not the whole Levitical tribe. But you had to be a direct prerequisite of Aaron. Which simply means you had to be from Aaron or Aaron's sons in order to do it. So we have here, they had on the right clothes. Notice something else. Notice in Exodus 29. Notice something. Exodus 29. You go down through chapters 28 and 29, you're going to see Aaron's sons. Notice verse number 4.
Yes, sir,
and Aaron and his sons. Verse number 9.
Into the door of the tabernacle of the congregation and shall wash them with water.
And shall wash them with water. That, you know, the door of the tabernacle. Come on. Let me show you what pattern theology is. When God called Moses up on Mount Sinai, Exodus 25, verses 8 and 9.
That's it. That's right.
He gave him the pattern that he needed to follow.
That's what it said, the pattern. That's it, brother.
One of the patterns was how to make this tabernacle.
That's it.
That tent type structure.
That's it.
Had to be laid both due east and west.
Yes, sir.
Why east? Yes, because the Levitical tribe camped, the prerequisite of Aaron camped in the east.
Yes, sir.
Oh, yes, they did.
All right.
Moses, Aaron, and those four boys, they camped right in the east, not in the west, not in the south. You see, the Kohath had to camp in the south.
Yes, sir.
Oh, yes. Merari camped in the north.
All right.
The Gershonites camped in the west. The Levitical tribe that was a prerequisite of Aaron was in the east.
Well,
that Old Testament church had to be laid both due east and west.
Right.
Oh, it was a tent type structure, wasn't it?
That's it.
That was 15 by 45.
That's it.
And then it was on the inside of an enclosure that was 150 feet long.
All right,
now, on the east end, there was only one entrance in that Old Testament church. On the east end, just like in the Church of Christ today, there's only one entrance in that neighborhood. You can't sway your way up in here. You can't now, 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 a boom, did a boom, boom, burn your way up in here. You can't do it. You got to obey your way in. That's the only way you get in. And then they had to wash because that was that large brass basin on that loft. It's sitting right outside of the door where Aaron and his boys had to wash their hands and feet before they went into that Old Testament church. That large brass basin, neighbor, in the New Testament, it represents baptism. And I'm so glad God got baptism on the outside of the church door, because maybe it keeps unbelievers out. He ain't never believe it. And his baptized shall be saved. See, all of you got to get into the New Testament church, neighbor, you got to be washed. And I know how come all of these denominational preachers, even some of our brethren that's taking in this sectarian baptism, I know why the devil and all these preachers don't want you to get baptized. You know why? Because you're bun belly when you're dry. That's why. You're bun belly when you're dry, neighbor. That's why God got baptism. Because, neighbor, baptism cleans you up. But if you got a denominational preacher don't want you to be baptized, neighbor, just get ready for some fire. And you show bun belly. Well, yes, you do, friend. God got baptism on the outside of the door, neighbor. It keeps unbelievers out. And here in this Old Testament church, this large brass basin known as a lava, those priests had to wash their hands and had to wash their feet before they entered into that Old Testament church. You can mark it down,
friend.
You can mark it down. Now, what did that passage say?
Aaron
and his son.
Thou shalt bring unto the door of the
tabernacle. Bring unto the door of the tabernacle. The
congregation, and shall wash them with water.
And shall wash them with water. And now you go all the way down through that.
That's it, brother.
Verse 19, the same thing. Verse 15, the same thing. Verse 21, notice the same thing. Aaron shall put it upon the garments and upon his sons. So now, what do we have? We got the right boys, do we not? Oh, yeah, we got the right boys. Look at verses 43 and verse 44 of Exodus 29.
And there I will meet with the children of Israel.
There he's going to meet with the children of Israel.
And the tabernacle shall be sanctified by my glory.
Now, we got the right boys. All of us can agree with that. These boys were the right priests. All of us can agree with that. Exodus 21. They had the right father. We all see that in Exodus 29. They were from the right tribe. Not only that, they are the right place. Now look what I want to look at. Go back to that Exodus 25. I want to look at this sacred place. What have we covered? We covered these boys had a special privilege worshiping God. These boys were the right boys, right priests, right father, right tribe, right place, right God. Had neighbor the right clothes on, they're going to use the right censer and the right incense and obeying God, but yet, fire instantaneously came out and destroyed them. Why would God do that? And all of these right things these boys are doing? Did God mistreat these boys? Did God do something wrong? Why would God destroy these boys with all of these right things these boys are doing.
Yes, sir.
Notice something here. In Exodus 25, verses 8 and verse number 9.
And let them make me a sanctuary, and I will dwell among them according to all that I show them.
Where?
After the pattern of the tabernacle, and the pattern of all instruments thereof, even so shall ye make it.
Notice verse number 40.
And look that they make them after their pattern, which was shown thee in the mount.
Here God called Moses.
She's pointing the pattern, bro.
Up on Mount Sinai. Oh yes, I'm getting that right now. God called Moses up on Mount Sinai.
That's all right, bro.
And when God called Moses up on Mount Sinai, our neighbor, he gave him a pattern.
That's right, brother.
A specific pattern. That pattern had to be exactly as the measurements that God said, neighbor.
Amen, brother.
It had to be exactly as God said.